Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and welcome to lecture number 22 for basic engineering mechanics. In this lecture we will cover the equilibrium of a rigid body in three dimensions, and we will first look at the equations for equilibrium in three dimensions, and then we'll look at constraints and statical determinacy, which basically means that sometimes we have more number of constraints and less equations to solve for them. So what are the possible cases that we can have that? And the third thing is that we will look at an example for a rigid body equilibrium in three dimensions. Okay, so first off, the equations of equilibrium for three dimensions is exactly what we discussed a few lectures ago, that we want that the sum of all the forces acting on that body should be equal to zero, and sum of all the moments acting on that body at any point should be equal to zero. And we saw earlier that these are necessary and sufficient equations. If these equations are true, that is enough for us to prove equilibrium. But these two are not scalar equations, these two are vector equations, and which basically means that in three dimensions both of these equations are basically a set of three equations composed into one equation. So what I basically mean is that when we say sum of all the forces is equal to zero, we mean that sum of all the forces in x and sum of all the forces in y direction and sum of all the forces in the z axis, all of them should be equal to zero for this vector equation to be true. And similarly for the moments, say sum of all the moments at O in the x direction and sum of all the moments at O in the y direction and sum of all the moments at O in the z direction should be equal to zero. So we have six equations. So each of these we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 equations. So at most we can solve for six unknowns using these six equations. So anytime we have a rigid body which is in equilibrium and we have at most six unknowns on that rigid body, we would be able to solve for those six unknowns using these six equations. Okay, so now we look at something which we call statical determinacy, which basically tells us that are we able to find all the unknowns, are we able to determine all the support reactions on a rigid body. So so in statical determinacy we have two conditions, two different cases. First case is something which is called a redundant constraint, which basically means that we have a system which has number of constraints on that system are greater than the number of equations to solve for those constraints. So the number of unknowns in our system is greater than the number of equations, then we would know that this system is indeterminate. So that system is called statically indeterminate, that we will not be able to solve for all unknowns, but rather we would be able to find equations relating the unknowns to each other. Okay, so basically the object would still be in equilibrium, but we won't be able to find all the support reactions using the analysis we have studied so far. So we can look at some so let's look at an example. Here we have a girder which has three supports. The support at A is a fixed support which generates two forces and one couple moment. And then we have these two roller supports at B and C. Each of these roller supports provide a vertically upward force. So we basically have a system which has five unknowns. So we have BY, CY, AX, AY and MA. All of these are unknowns. And because this is a two-dimensional system, so we only have three equations of equilibrium. We have sum of all the forces in x is equal to 0, sum of all the forces in y is equal to 0, and we have that sum of all the moments is equal to 0. So in two dimensions, this system is, we can say that this is an indeterminate system, that all of these unknowns, we won't be able to find all of these unknowns just because we don't have enough equations to solve. Okay, so we can also have a statically indeterminate system in three dimensions. So here we have this system which has a fixed support at B, and this, there's a pipe system, and this has a pin support at A. And just by looking at it, because of this fixed support, we have six unknowns. Just from this fixed support, we have Bx, By, Bz, and Mx, My, and Mz. And then we have, because of this support, we have two unknowns, Ay and Az. So the total number of unknowns in this system are 8, but the number, total number of equations that we can solve for equilibrium are 6 equations. The equation just that we saw a few slides ago. So this again is the number of unknowns is greater than the number of equations. So this is again a statically indeterminate system. So all hopes is not lost. We can still solve these systems. There are two basic techniques that we use. First is the technique of seeing how our system would deform because of these forces. So that is not part of this course, our discussion today, but we can look at the deformation of different parts of our rigid body to see which of these forces are more important and which of the supports are going to provide a greater support than the other. And the second case is something that we will discuss in a few lectures, is that we would, so if we look here, this MZ is trying to stop rotation in the Z direction of this pipe. But the same thing can also be achieved by this AY force, because this would also stop the rotation of this pipe in the Z direction. So we would say that essentially these two supports are doing something which is very similar. So we can neglect MZ, that the purpose of MZ would be fulfilled by this AY support. So this is something else that we can do to simplify our system and to reduce the number of unknowns in our system. Okay, so this was the first type of indeterminacy that we can have in a rigid body which is in equilibrium, and that is that we have statical indeterminacy, that the number of unknowns is greater than the number of equations. But there is another possibility, which is that we can have a case where the number of unknowns is actually equal to the number of equations, but still some equations do not have a solution. And basically what that boils down to is that the support is not provided in any particular in one particular rotation or translation. That means that we would still won't be able to solve for equilibrium. That basically means that the body would not be in equilibrium. As we see here, we have this girder which has a pin support at A and which has a roller support at B, and this pin support would provide AX and AY two support reactions, and this roller support at B would provide a single support reaction, and we have this active force which is equal to P. And notice that this P would produce a clockwise moment in this roller, and there is nothing, all of these forces are concurrent at A, so these forces will not provide any moment at A, so that this system is not going to be in equilibrium. And if we were to have a real system like this, it would actually start to accelerate. In this case, this would start to rotate. So if we have improper constraints, then the object will actually be not in equilibrium. So this is different from the previous case where we had an over constrained system. So an over constrained system is still going to be in equilibrium, but we will not be able to solve for all the support reactions. But a system which has improper constraints is going to be out of equilibrium, and so the equilibrium conditions actually do not hold in that case. Okay, so there can be many different types of improper constraints. So so one of the types is that all the support forces are concurrent at a point, as we saw in the previous slide. So in this case, all these three, we have these three support forces, and all of them are concurrent at this point A. Now the body is free to rotate about the A axis. So if there is any force which is active force which is also not concurrent at point A, that force would provide a moment about this point A, and there is no support to cancel that moment. So that's the first case. The second case is that all the support forces are, even if we have all the support forces which are parallel in two dimensions, then the body can always translate in the perpendicular direction to all the support forces. So that's the case which is shown here. If we have a girder which is placed on these two rollers, and then we apply this force P, and we can see that this, the vertical component of this P force would be cancelled out by the two forces FA and FB, but the horizontal component of this force cannot be cancelled because there is no support reaction along the x-axis. So this body can always translate perpendicular to the forces. We can have improper constraints in three dimensions. So if all the support forces intersect along an axis, so if all the support forces lie along a single axis, so if we were to find the moment of that body about that axis, the moment provided by all of these forces about that axis would be equal to zero, which means that any force which is, which does not pass from that axis would be able to rotate our body along that axis. So again, this would be a case which that our body will not be in equilibrium. Okay, the other case is that if all the support forces are parallel, even as in, as was the case in two dimensions, if all the support forces are parallel, we still would have a improper constraint system even in three dimensions, so that the body can always translate perpendicular to all the support forces. Okay, so now that we have seen that improper constraints and statical indeterminacy, now let's look at an example. So here in this example, we want to determine the components of the reaction that the ball and socket joint at A, the smooth journal bearing at B, and the roller support at C exert on the rod assembly in figure 5-29A. So we have this pipe assembly which has only one active force, and it has a support reaction. We have the first support reaction at A, and this support reaction is a pin support, which basically it's a ball and socket joint, which means that this provides support reactions in terms of forces. So the first step again is to draw a free body diagram, and in this case actually I'll draw the free body diagram on top of my image. Ideally you should draw the sketch out the image in a separate place, but just to make things clearer, let's just draw the free body diagram. So to draw the free body diagram, I need, so let me increase the size. So there would be three support reactions, which would be one in this direction, the other one in x direction, other one in the x direction, and the third one in the z direction. Okay, so we get these three support reactions because of this ball and socket joint, and then we would have a single support reaction because of this point C. So this support reaction would be again vertically upwards. Okay, so let me use Okay. And this smooth journal bearing would provide two support reactions. So it is going to stop this object from moving in either the X or the Z direction. So we have these six supports on this rigid body. The next step again is to label all of the support reactions, so we can we know which forces we have. So we can label this as FAZ, this one can be FAX, and the third one can be FAY. Similarly, this one can be BZ, FBZ, and FBX, and this one I can say FC. I can use the terms because this is only a single, the direction is already obvious, so I do not have to write a Z here, but you can always choose to write a Z. So now we would write all the six equations of equilibrium. So the first one, let's start with the easiest one. So the easiest one in this case is maybe the sum of all the forces in y direction is equal to zero. And so there is only one force in the y direction, which is FAY. So this basically implies that FAY should be equal to zero. The second equation is for the X. So sum of all the forces in X is equal to zero. And so we only have two forces in X. One is FAX and one is FBX, which basically then this implies that FAX is going to be equal to the negative of FBX. So we have two equations are down. We still need four more. Sum of all the forces in Z equals to zero, and so we have 1, 2, 3, 4 equation, four forces in Z. So basically we have FAZ plus FBZ plus FC minus 900, and the whole thing is already equal to zero. Okay, so these are the equations of the forces, and so I can choose any point to find the resultant moment. So let's just choose this point A. So I'm going to apply the sum of all the moments equation at A is equal to zero. So sum of all the moments at A in X direction, all these three forces are not going to provide any moment at point A. So this FBX is going to provide a moment, which is going to be so the MAX is the moment provided in the X direction. So the only force that would, the only these two forces would provide a moment in the X direction. So the, and this would be this force would provide a counterclockwise moment, a clockwise moment. So that would be equal to 900 times the perpendicular distance, which is 0.4. That's the perpendicular distance from here to here. Let me use a different color so that, so the perpendicular distance is this, and then we would have this force FC is providing a counterclockwise moment, which is equal to, so this comes with a minus sign, we get a plus, and that is 1.2, that is the perpendicular distance, times FC. And this FBZ force would provide a moment, which is equal to again a plus sign times 0.8 times FBZ. So that was the sum of all the moments in X. Similarly, sum of all the moments in Y is going to give us so which forces provide a moment in the Y direction? Only this force, this 900 Newton force and FC provide a moment in the Y direction. So I get and this one is going to be clockwise and this one is going to be counterclockwise. So I get 900 times 0.4. Now this 0.4, so this plus, we get FC times 0.6, FC times 0.6, and this is equal to 0. And this is an equation that we can directly solve for FC, and we get that FC is very simply given by 900 times 0.4 divided by 0.6, which turns out to be equal to 600 Newton. So we have FC now. Let me change the color, and we have one more equation to write. So the last equation is the equation for sum of all the moments in Z, and the only force which is providing moment along the Z axis is this force FPX. So we get FPX times 0.8, and this is equal to 0, which implies that FPX is equal to 0. We have already solved three of the unknowns. We know that we have already solved for the three unknowns. We know that FPX is equal to 0, FAY is equal to 0, and FC is equal to 600 Newton. And now we can solve the other three equations. So from this equation, FAX is equal to minus FPX, and as FPX is equal to 0, this implies that FAX also should be equal to 0. So the only equations remaining to solve is these two equations. So because we already know FC, so we can solve for FBZ. FBZ turns out to be equal to, from this equation, this turns out to be equal to minus 450 Newtons. And the only remaining unknown now is just FAZ, which we can find from this equation. And this is minus 900, and this is 600, and this is minus 450. And we get 750 Newtons. So now we have solved for all of the unknowns. Let me just draw boxes to highlight all the unknowns that we have. So this is two of the support reactions, that's the third, that's the fourth, that's the fifth, and that's the sixth. So this is how we can use the six equations for equilibrium to find the unknown support reactions. So that is it for today, and I'll see you in the lecture number 23, where we will start off with our next chapter, which is about structural analysis. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.